Okay, Psalm 2. Psalm 2. I'm gonna read the entire Psalm, verses 1 through 2. Psalm 2, 1 through 12. Why are the nations in an uproar, and the peoples devising a vain thing? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us tear down their fetters apart and cast away their cords from us. He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. Then he will speak to them in his anger and terrify them in his fury, saying, but as for me, I have installed my king upon Zion, my holy mountain. I will surely tell of the decree of the Lord. He said to me, you are my son, today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will surely give the nations as your inheritance, and the very ends of the earth as your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron. You shall shatter them like earthenware. Now therefore, O kings, show discernment. Take warning, O judges of the earth. Worship the Lord with reverence and rejoice with trembling. Do homage to the Son, that he not become angry and you perish in the way. For his wrath may soon be kindled. How blessed are all who take refuge in him. If you want to understand or better understand and get a glimpse of how God sees this world through his eyes, you discover it and find it right here in Psalm 2. This is how God sees this world. Many fail to see it. Many fail, even among God's own people, fail to understand the attitude and to see this world as God himself truly sees it. Stephen Charnock said this, to be God and sovereign are inseparable. God is in control. And as much as man may seek to set himself up as the Almighty, man is incapable of overthrowing God. That's pretty arrogant, isn't it? For man to believe that he can actually overthrow the will of God. And so Psalm 2 here shows us a cosmic revolt, a cosmic rebellion throughout this world that began in the Garden of Eden with Adam. And so what we see in Psalm 2 here is a rebellion against supreme authority. And the psalmist tells us, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit of God, that man will fail in his rebellion against God. Man is up against a losing battle in setting himself up against God. And no matter how depraved man might become, he will never destroy nor tear down God's sovereign authority over this world. Man's puny efforts cannot overcome God's sovereignty. And so what do we see here in Psalm 2? What does Psalm 2 tell us? It tells us that there is an ongoing rebellion against God. It also tells us that man will fail in his ridiculous attempts to defy God. Psalm 2 also tells us of a promised future day that will come with certainty. And that the world's rejection or the world's rebellion against God really boils down to its rejection of Jesus Christ. Psalm 2 tells us that all of man's efforts, all of his attempts to take over this world will falter and fail. And it tells us that in the end time, in the last day, that even unbelievers will bow down and acknowledge Jesus Christ as Lord. Man can either bow down to Jesus Christ now, voluntarily. He can now submit to the will of God voluntarily. Or, in the end, he will find himself bowing before God, the judge, begging for a mercy that will not be granted. And so for the note takers, I want you to leave here this morning understanding this. God invites men to accept his grace or to face his wrath. God invites men, all men, to accept his grace or to face his wrath. And the first thing we can glean from Psalm 2 is that lost man is united in his rebellion against God. Lost man is united in his rebellion against God. And so Psalm 2 tells us that sinful man is guilty of defiance against God. It's really, if you think about it, an issue of spiritual insanity. It's spiritual insanity. To set oneself up against and to oppose God Almighty. So what we see here is that sin has corrupted man's thinking. Sin has destroyed the core being of man's soul. It has destroyed his heart. Think about it. Who in their right mind would actually seek to overthrow God? That's spiritual insanity. The psalmist actually tells us here, or he defines this rebellion or this defiance as a conspiracy. You know, you ever hear in our world today about conspiracies? All kind of conspiracy theories, aren't they? And when men look at and come to this conclusion that there is a conspiracy going on, quite often they're right, but they really don't understand it. See, they have this mentality that there are men sitting around in places, high offices in government, devising this conspiracy. There is a conspiracy, but what men fail to understand is these conspiracies have been devised by Satan, the ruler of this cosmic dark world, who is manipulating men to do his bidding. Therefore, it looks like a conspiracy among men. A global rebellion against the one and only true God. A global rebellion, the psalmist says, against God's anointed. Who is God's anointed? Jesus Christ. And God is very clear. God makes himself very clear to us through the psalmist here. In Psalms 2, God says, God's word says that man's plan is in vain. All of man's plans are empty and destined to fail. And get this. Hear this well, folks. It is political and national leaders who lead this resistance and this rebellion against God. It is political and national leaders around this world who are leading this resistance, this rebellion against God. And you don't have to look far to see it. Human history has demonstrated this fact over and over and over again. Nations, empires, political leaders have been seen throughout history resisting, not only resisting, but actually opposing the will of God. You say, what is the will of God, Richard? Well, number one, the will of God is for us to believe on his son, Jesus Christ. Number two, Jesus prayed, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You think they're killing babies in heaven? Don't think so. This rebellion amongst political and national leaders, it was demonstrated clearly in the arrest, in the trials, and the condemnation of Jesus Christ himself by leaders such as Annas, Caiaphas, Pilate, and Herod. There were others. This rebellion has been witnessed even in our lifetime by despotic, evil dictators all over this world. Some who have literally murdered millions of people. We're witnessing rebellion this very day in our own nation, folks. Men, political leaders in the highest offices of federal and state and local governments thumbing their noses at God. And the Bible says this attitude will increase in the last days. A world, a nation, oh, hear me, a world and a nation whose desire is to be free from the sovereign control of God. The heart of sin is the repudiation of God's rule in the affairs of man. It is the desire to rule through self. Luke 19 and 14 says, we do not want this man to reign over us. It's a story that Jesus told, illustrating that he came unto his own, and his own received him not. They rejected him. They said to him, we do not want you to rule over us. They were not interested in submitting to the will of God then. They're not willing to submit to the will of God, to the rule of God today. Why? Because they have determined to go their own way, to make their own rules. You know, that's what the scribes and the Pharisees did. They made their own rules. Not only did they make their own rules, they enforced their own rules upon people. And they didn't care what God thought. Man has clearly demonstrated his insane, depraved, sinful condition. Lost man is united in his rebellion against God. And God invites all men to accept his grace or to face his wrath. Second theme we see in Psalm 2 is this: God is not amused by man's rebellious attitude. God is not amused by man's rebellious attitude. We have a picture here of God sitting on his throne and laughing at the arrogant boastings of man. He's not laughing in a sense of hilarity. Listen, there's nothing funny about rebelling against God, folks. So God's not laughing out of hilarity. He's laughing with derision. He's laughing at mockery. He's laughing at contempt. As I didn't know if I was going to say this this morning, but I'm going to go ahead and say it. As I was preparing this message last night, I thought of a pissant. A pissant's really an actual name of an ant. And it's almost as if a pissant is looking up at a 2,000-pound rhinoceros telling him, I'm going to whip you. That's insane, isn't it? And yet here is man thumbing up his nose at God, shaking his fist at God, and saying, I'll have my way, I refuse to do it your way. That's insanity, folks. Man is guilty of shaking his fist in the face of God. It's bizarre. It's insane. And God is actually ridiculing and mocking man's emptiness. What man fails to understand is this laughter will one day turn into fury. This laughter will one day turn into the wrath of God. Why? Because God is holy. And God's holiness will move him to one day judge rebellion. So what we see here is God is actually speaking a word of burning indignation. Do you know this? You won't hear this in many pulpits. Do you understand that God hates and rejects all who commit sin? So what do you mean, Rich? All you got to do, go to Psalm 5 and read verse 5. Psalmist said, you hate all who do iniquity. Some folk have ripped that page out of the Bible. Not only that, God's word says that God is angry with the wicked every day. Read it, Psalm 7 and verse 11. God is a righteous judge and a God who has indignation every day. Now, how many folks do you think picture God that way today with messages coming from most pulpits? That's a foreign message. Many do not understand this particular characteristic of God. The psalmist says that God has appointed his king. He's appointed his king, Jesus Christ, to rule and to reign. He says that King Jesus is coming again. It's already been once. Came to save man from his sin. He's coming again to put down all rebellion and have his way. The Bible says that God the Father has given Jesus Christ the Son all authority in heaven and in earth. He's coming back to rule this planet. He's coming back to put down all rebellion. And yes, he's coming back, the Bible says, to overthrow and to judge everybody that opposes him. Set up a righteous government, the first and the last. God is not amused by man's rebellious attitude. God invites men to accept his grace or to face his wrath. Third thing we see this morning from the psalmist is that God will execute his intentions and his plans. God created man with purpose. God